Thank you. Hemodynamic management during ECMO, venous ECMO. These are my conflict of interest. And hemodynamic management in our center is done based on the use of a Swan-Ganz catheter. The use of this Swan-Ganz catheter has been criticized pretty much. As far as the RDS is concerned, this is a fundamental study from the NIH ARDS network. It showed that Swan-Ganz is not really useful, and more complications than used in ARDS. Unfortunately, 38% of the potential patients that could be enrolled were not enrolled because they are already as Swan-Ganz. So I think that what we can really say today about Swan-Ganz is that perhaps it does not save lives, but it does not increase mortality. And what we can say is that in ECMO management, Swan-Ganz is a great help, and I will try to show you that this is true, obviously within certain limits. First of all, the in severe hypoxemia, having a Swan-Ganz helps you. First of all, it provides you cardiac output, and it really provides you the factors then at play in the generation of arterial oxygen saturation. Manipulating the cardiac output is one of the ways of changing arterial oxygenation. Moreover, ARDS, and particularly ARDS patients severely sick, so sick to undergo ECMO, are very often affected by pulmonary hypertension. And pulmonary hypertension, you can estimate it with, as an example, by echocardiography, but you measure it with a Swan-Ganz. You all know what venous ECMO is, and I will not spend time on it. This slide just shows you that we mostly use femoral cannulation, because this kind of cannulation is the one that allows the easiest hemodynamic monitoring, even if it does not maximize blood flow. In oxygen, if we look at oxygen delivery during ECMO, oxygen delivery is affected by two systems. One is the natural lung, and the other one is the artificial lung. Each one of those follows its own rules. For sure, through the natural lung goes all the cardiac output. The difference between the two is that the natural lung sees the entire cardiac output, while the artificial lung sees a fraction only of the cardiac output. Now, how does venous ECMO work? This is a very simple concept. It's extremely simple, but it is very important that everybody grabs this concept. Venous oxygenation, venous ECMO, does not directly improve arterial oxygenation. Venous ECMO acts on mixed venous saturation. As an example, the effect. If we have a patient, an hypoxemic patient, with 50% mixed venous oxygen saturation, and this patient that has 50% shunt, 50% of the lung is not ventilated. This 50% shunt blood flow goes through the lung and gets out with the same mixed venous oxygen saturation. It gets into the artery and mixes with the arterialized blood coming from the good part of the lung. If the shunt is 50%, the arterial saturation will be the mixture of 50% mixed venous blood and 50% arterialized blood. So if I mix 50% mixed venous saturation with 100% arterialized blood, I get 75% saturation. This will correspond roughly to a VO2 of 40. Now, if I apply veno-venous ECMO and I raise mixed venous saturation from 50 to 75, now I will be mixing 75% with 100% and I will get 87.5% saturation, PO2 of 58. It's not an excellent PO2, but it's a survivable PO2. It is important to notice that the effect of increasing mixed venous saturation is bigger the shunt of the patient. Veno-venous ECMO in a patient with a normal lung will not change arterial saturation sizably. The effect of a veno-venous ECMO is bigger the sicker the patient, the higher the intrapulmonary shunt. The extreme patient, 100% shunt, will have an arterial saturation that will be equal to the mixed venous, usually a little lower. First of all, we need to know cardiac output, because the changes in arterial oxygenation during ECMO are not only function of the natural lung. Here, this is a model we have, you can go online and use it if you like, that shows, as an example, in this patient with 40% shunt, you might see a decrease in arterial oxygenation, but the patient is not getting sicker. Simply is increasing his own cardiac output. With machine as a fixed cardiac output, you set the blood flow of the machine. But the cardiac output of the patient might change. And when the cardiac output increases, you might see that under certain conditions, PO2 goes down. So you must know what's going on. And to do that, you must be able to evaluate cardiac output. So, I think one of the most reliable ways to measure cardiac output is the Swan-Ganz catheter. You can follow it almost continuously. With some of the devices, you can follow it really continuously. Now let's go to hemodynamic monitoring. Veno-venous ECMO does not affect directly systemic arterial pressure, does not affect directly central venous pressure. Wedge does not affect wedge pressure directly, indirectly it might, cardiac output is affected only if, as far as it relieves hypoxemic hyperdynamic status. What ECMO changes directly, and this is worse unsuspected, is pulmonary arterial pressure and right ventricular function. Less than the veno arterial bypass, but still. Most severe ARDS patients have pulmonary hypertension. This pulmonary hypertension is caused by a series of factors. First of all, the ARDS is a microvascular disease that includes the microcirculation of the lung. This is known since the 70s. The microvasculature of the lung is occupied by microthrombi, and inflammation contributes to the occlusion of the microvasculature of the natural lung. Then we have another factor, which is mechanical ventilation. Mechanical ventilation itself and high airway pressure increase pulmonary vascular resistance. But then we have other factors we can manipulate directly. Hypoxemia and hypoxia directly increase pulmonary vascular resistances, as well as hypercardia and acidosis. When therapeutic hypercapnia or permissive hypercapnia came around as one of the way of preventing ventilator-induced lung injury, one of the major side effects was right ventricular dysfunction, because high PCO2 and low pH caused pulmonary artery circulation vasoconstriction. And then we could partially correct it by the use of nitric oxide, as an example. The other factor that contributes to pulmonary artery hypertension in ARDS is a beneficial effect, which is hypoxic vasoconstriction. Hypoxic vasoconstriction redistributes blood flow to the ventilated regions. But this is done at the cost of an increased right ventricular work. So let's see. I show you data from Monza, where I've been working up to 2015. And these are 34 patients undergoing ECMO. And I focus initially on what happens when we start ECMO. This is mean arterial pulmonary artery pressure. Before was this 32.6, average becomes 27. There is a substantial decrease, at least 15%. And this decrease is present in all pulmonary hypertension patients. The arterial pH gets corrected from 7.3 to 7.4. PCO2 decreases from 64 to 53. We could get it lower, but if we get it lower suddenly, we have very bad side effects. Shunt increases when we start ECMO. Starting ECMO increases shunt because we relieve pulmonary vascular vasoconstriction due to hypoxia. And this has a good effect on hemodynamics, but it worsens the intrapulmonary shunt. This is the pulmonary artery pressure after ECMO, individual cases. This is a long, during the course of ECMO, the evolution of pulmonary artery pressure during the first week and percentage-wise during the course of ECMO. And you see that in patients that survive, most of them, pulmonary artery pressure not only steps down after initiation of ECMO, but keeps going down. But it goes up in patients that do badly. This is intrapulmonary shunt. You see that there is a jump up in the intrapulmonary shunt at the start of ECMO. Of course, to compute shunt, you need a real mixed venous blood gas. This is pulmonary artery pressure in 100 patients, more than 100, 111, I guess, if I remember correctly, and mortality. The higher the pulmonary artery pressure, the higher the mortality. This is what is of interest is shunt according to pulmonary artery pressure. PEEP, this is another important message. During ECMO, the low PEEP is associated to a higher incidence of pulmonary hypertension. A collapsed lung increases its pulmonary artery pressure. Vascular resistances are higher if you have a collapsed lung. And this is what makes you shift to veno arterial bypass. Obviously, we should not forget that echocardiography is a very powerful monitoring. But my message is, echocardiography is essential. Pulmonary artery pressure monitoring is the tool to monitor the pathophysiology during it. And by that, I end here, because my time is over, right? And that is the message. We are lucky enough that the veno-venous femoral cannulation allows us to monitor very strictly central hemodynamics in these patients. Thank you very much.